I worked the fields in Tennessee, but dreamed of better days. I left the plow and the picking bag to join the homestead grays. All summer long we played the states, then headed south for fall. Through rain and dust we rode the bus so we could play baseball. We played for love, we played for pride, and seldom made much more. The bread and beans, the hotel bugs, the roads where crowds don't roar. The all-night rides, the seedy side came with the life we chose. But we made do and we came through, 'cause we were pros. We played in shadows of the Babe, Lou Gehrig and the rest, and stood outside the big league fence while they were called the best. But we played as well and gave up with every hit and pitch, but stayed behind the color line and watched those boys get rich. But did they see Josh Gibson swing or Satchel throw his stuff? And do you know how much it takes when best is not enough? When clouds roll in across the sky and hide the brightest moon, it's then you'll find some stars don't shine. Some folks were born too soon. God bless you, Jackie Robinson, Willie Mays and all. You wore numbers on your backs when you played big league ball. And every time you hit one out or slid or laid one down, you carried us from that old bus to the hall of Cooperstown.
Good morning and welcome to Cooperstown, New York, the spiritual home of baseball. You know, the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum is here because legend has it that the first baseball game was played here in Cooperstown in 1839. And about 350,000 people make the pilgrimage to this beautiful little village every year, and it really is special. And if you haven't been here, we'd love to have you come join us. Tell your moms and dads, because we'd love to have you come and experience the Hall of Fame sometime. I'll give you a little geography lesson. We're 70 miles west of Albany, so go to your map of New York and look for the state capital of Albany and go west 70 miles, and that's where we are. Now, it's taken 62 years for 12 million people to make the pilgrimage to Cooperstown, but today we are going to reach 15 million students across this great country all the way to Alaska. Now, 15 million students is the equivalent of the Rose Bowl filled 150 times. That's 100,000 people times 150. A lot of people don't realize that we're a nonprofit educational institution, and we are so proud to be part of the world's largest classroom today. We are also a lot more than people realize. People think we're a small gallery of plaques. Our gallery is actually 5,000 square feet of a 60,000 square foot museum. And we have 165,000 artifacts, 500,000 historic photographs, 5,000 hours of original TV and radio recordings, 2 million documents in our library, and our researchers answer 60,000 questions a year. So we have a pretty big operation here. And we really exist for three reasons: to preserve history, to honor excellence, and to connect generations. You know, history has a way of repeating itself. And if you'll remember back to September 11th, when we had the horrific events on New York and Washington, President Bush and Commissioner Selig, the baseball commissioner, had to decide whether to suspend the game or keep it going. They made the decision that for 6 days they would suspend the game to give people a chance to grieve and then get the country back on its feet. Well, the same thing happened during World War II, at the beginning of World War II, when Commissioner Landis asked President Roosevelt what should be done. And we have a famous letter here called the Green Light Letter, in which President Roosevelt responds back to Commissioner Landis that the game ought to keep going for the good of the people. Now, we're going to start the program in our Grandstand Theater. We're going to walk in And the Grandstand Theater is a replica of old Comiskey Park, which was in existence from 1901 to 1990. And what a lot of people don't realize is that in addition to being the home of the Chicago White Sox from 1941 to 1950, it was also the home to the Chicago American Giants, the great Negro Leagues team. So we're going to join Doug in the Grandstand Theater now.
Thanks, Dale. I'm here with a big crowd in the Grandstand Theater. And with me are two students who are going to talk to us about the program today. First, I want to just say that we have a unique opportunity here to look at history itself and American culture through baseball. With me are Ellen and Gavin.
Welcome to the Baseball Hall of Fame. We are located in the Grandstand Theater where the place is packed. I'm Gavin Harris.
And I'm Ellen Miller. And now we'd like to introduce the schools in our audience.
Cooperstown Middle School.
Hey, let's hear it for them. Hey.
Amsterdam High School and Lynch Middle School.
Brooklyn 13.
Hey.
And Harlem RBI.
Okay, we're going to be fortunate enough to have with us some guests to talk about the connection between baseball and history. Because we're in the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum, we'll be looking at some of the artifacts, like the green light letter that we saw earlier, and learn about their connection to American culture. With us in the audience is Stephanie and Duke.
Thanks, Doug. I'm in the audience, and I'll be taking questions from any of the students that have questions here in the audience. But we haven't forgot those of you at home, right, Duke?
That's right, Stephanie. There are ways for you at home to get your questions answered, too. You could either call the 1-800 number that's on our screen, or you could email us.
You make sure you turn down your television set when you call in, though, so we don't get any nasty feedback.
I'm going to send it down to Virginia on the keyboard.
Lesser known musical pieces associated with baseball.
Why does that happen? Okay,
Doug.
Voice thing?
Okay, thank you.
Why does it happen that you're not hearing a voice very well? Is it better for them?
Because you're not on program.
Oh, okay, good.
Here.
So it's better.
Specifically, we're going to look at some of the ethnic groups and their struggle for acceptance in baseball. Not just in baseball, but the corresponding American society, too. With me are Pete and Matt.
And one of the things we're going to do today is we really hope to entertain you and to teach you. And I think the guests that we have, obviously we talked about the fact that we are going to be your classroom for the day. And with some of the guests that we have assembled here, it's definitely going to be very entertaining, very educational, and a whole lot of fun as well.
We'll be seeing different angles on baseball, things that you don't normally get in an average program. And we will get to see some new people, some authorities in the field. And just the talent assembled here is absolutely tremendous.
Well, one of the things that I'm looking forward to is to look at, especially during Black History Month, look at segregation and the effect that segregation had. How people, when they were segregated, found ways to still pursue the sport that they love and really shine in the sport they love. So eventually what's going to happen is that integration really becomes necessary. If we love the sport, then we definitely want to see the best players playing this sport and playing the sport with the best competition against each other.
And Doug, integration is something I think is not emphasized enough, that, you know, people hear the kind of negative aspects of the Negro Leagues and the segregation, but one of the things the Negro League will be the first to tell you is that they just wanted to play baseball and they just loved the opportunity, and the integration was really something that, you know, they speak about and talk very highly of, that I think we'll get, you know, a sense of much later in the show.
What we're looking at is multiculturalism and the untold stories of baseball, and I think the untold stories of baseball essentially are ignored stories of baseball sometimes. And not just looking at the Negro Leagues, but we can look at other ethnic groups who have been excluded, and eventually their fight and struggle for inclusion in American society through their struggle in baseball.
And we'll look at the Japanese Americans. Right, and I bet that Pete's done some work with Japanese Americans and their struggles, and, you know, very parallel to the things that the Negro Leaguers and some of the African Americans went through.
Yes, we have Kerryo Nakagawa here today, who is a foremost authority on the Japanese American baseball experience. Japan received baseball in 1872, excuse me, and they brought it with them to the United States and are very, very passionate about the game. And ironically, any Asian American, it seemed, that wanted to play professional baseball had to go back to Japan. So he'll fill us in on that.
Well, joining us is Bruce Markinson, who is one of the managers of the museum, and Ted Spencer, the curator of the museum. Bruce and Ted?
Thank you very much, Doug. Good morning, everyone. I'm with Ted Spencer, who's the chief curator here at the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum. Ted, we have a lot of ground to cover today, but give us a little bit of a sneak preview toward one of the highlights that you'll be discussing today.
What we'll be talking about is the development of our exhibit here in the Hall of Fame, Pride and Passion, the African-American Baseball Experience. We'll talk about the story of the African-American in baseball. Also, we'll talk about the effect that the war had on integration. And also what we'll do is I'll tell a little story on how a recently elected Hall of Famer found his dad in this picture in one of our exhibits.
Also coming up later today, I'll have a chance to talk about someone who's really in the news. Later today, Frank Robinson is expected to be named the new manager of the Montreal Expos. He would become the seventh current black manager in the major leagues. Well, you go back to 1975. Frank Robinson pictured in this 1975 Topps baseball card with the Cleveland Indians. He was a player for the Indians. He was also their manager. That's when he became the first African-American manager in Major League history. So it's very interesting how things come full circle. We'll talk a lot more about Frank Robinson, both as a player and as a manager. Let's now send it back to Doug Kaufman, Matt Flint, and Peter Henrici in the Grandstand Theater here at the Hall of Fame. Guys?
Thanks, Bruce. Thanks, Ted. One of the things that we talked about looking at is the influence of blacks in baseball, and that after Jackie Robinson broke the color barrier in 1947, it took quite a while, 1975, before Frank Robinson became the first black manager in baseball. That's one of the things we're going to look at, but there's other highlights that we're looking forward to in this program.
I think the highlights are going to be hearing firsthand accounts and stories of people who have lived through these and played with and against these people, like Buck O'Neill. We also have Roberto Clemente Jr. and Sharon Robinson with us, who I can't wait to hear some of their stories and their information input.
And the staff here at the Hall of Fame will also contribute their knowledge as to why they put together certain exhibits and how carefully they went about it.
Well, with us, as this is something that Matt mentioned, with us today is Buck O'Neill and Larry Hogan, Dr. Larry Hogan, who is an expert on the Negro Leagues. Buck?
Yes.
What would you like to talk about during the program?
LL Cool J said, education is the most rewarding thing you can ever do for yourself. It's like a garden in your mind. I am 90 years old, and that it's still growing in my mind. So I tell you children, I'm going to be there when you finish high school. I'm going to be there when you finish college, because you got to go all the way. See, I had a little problem when I came along, but you don't have any problem at all. Yes, we straighten that out. Yeah. And you're going to change some things in this country just like we did.
There's some words of wisdom. There's some words of wisdom right there from Buck O'Neill.
Definite words to live by.
And with us also is Dr. Larry Hogan. Dr. Larry Hogan, what would you like to talk about?
Well, I'm so impressed with what Buck is saying, of course. And the straightening out that Buck and his generation did is a big part of what we'll be talking about today. We'll get into the history of the Negro Leagues. And the title of today's program is Untold Stories. There are numerous untold stories. One that I'd like to start out and then perhaps pick up on later into the program is the story of a gentleman named Max Manning, an educator who taught for some 28 years in the public schools in Pleasantville, New Jersey. Before he did that, he was a great Negro League pitcher. In 1946, Max came back from the war. He had served in European theater. He served in the theater in Japan, okay, and picked up his career in the Negro Leagues. 46 was a great season. The Newark Eagles, he pitched for them that year. They won the Negro League World Series that year. And it was Buck, as a matter of fact, who was on the opposite team, the Kansas City Monarchs, with the legendary Satchel Paige. Max was so great that year that the Negro National League awarded him a watch, which was emblematic of being the best pitcher in the Negro Leagues. It would be the equivalent of the Cy Young Award today. And this was something that Max treasured across the years. His daughter, Belinda, fondly recalls their father going into the bedroom, into the drawer, in the dresser, and pulling this out and showing it to them, and the pride they felt in his career in the majors. But Max always prized his teaching career ahead of the Negro Leagues, as great a pitcher as he was. We'll come back and pick this story up later on in our Untold Stories today.
Okay, what we're going to do now is we're going to bring it over to the integration of baseball. We're going to move the story forward a little bit from the Negro Leagues and talk a little bit about the integration of baseball. We're very fortunate to have with us Sharon Robinson, the daughter of Jackie Robinson, who in 1947 integrated baseball by joining the Brooklyn Dodgers. With Mrs. Robinson is students Amy, Sean, and Amin. Sharon?
Good morning. Since we're talking about untold stories and social change, I think the untold story about my father is his involvement in the civil rights movement after he left baseball. He really saw his role not just as a baseball player, but really as a social activist. And as he was retiring from baseball, the civil rights movement was heating up. And my father jumped right in, became a fundraiser for the NAACP. Then he continued to march with Dr. Martin Luther King, Ralph Abernathy, and many other of the leaders, also inspiring the kids in the South as they integrated their schools. So his mission continued throughout his life and continues today. We work on, as we work towards continuing social change. Here we are celebrating Frank Robinson becoming another black manager, and really, you know, just shows you we have a lot of work yet to be done. Back to you, Doug.
Thanks, Sharon. When we're looking at the integration of baseball, we are looking at one particular ethnic group. And I think that one of the untold stories is to look at some of the other ethnic groups and their impact on history.
Right. One of the things we're going to see, too, is that, you know, obviously having Sharon Robinson there to tell her, you know, her father's story is great. And one of the things we're going to see is kind of a parallel to Roberto Clemente in the fact that he was kind of a Latino groundbreaker in the same way that Jackie Robinson was.
Mm-hmm. Well, with Sharon Robinson, what we see is the integration of baseball, but we're also going to look at, as I said, other ethnic groups. And I'd like to throw it now to Bruce and Roberto, who are going to talk about Roberto Clemente Jr. So Roberto Clemente Jr., Bruce?
I'm with Roberto Clemente Jr., the eldest son of the late, great Roberto Clemente Walker, Hall of Famer for the Pittsburgh Pirates. Roberto, there's a lot to talk about with your father, but give us a little bit of an idea of one of the highlights that we'll be discussing today.
Well, we'll be talking about his passion of the game, but how he came up and grew up as a Latin American, trying to get to the major leagues and making a difference, and how he became the person that he was. And just to become that, it had to do with the Negro Leagues. He actually watched that in Puerto Rico growing up, and became very, very a big-time fan of the Negro Leagues, and that's how he became a baseball player in Puerto Rico. So we'll be talking about that a little bit later on.
Another interesting fact about Roberto Clemente, he was a great Winter League star in his native Puerto Rico. On this date, February 12th in 1955, Roberto Clemente and another Hall of Famer, Willie Mays, both hit home runs for the Santurce Crabbers to give Santurce the championship of the Caribbean World Series. So a little bit of history being made today, way back in 1955. Roberto, thank you very much. We'll hear from you a little bit later on. Let's send it back to Doug Kaufman in the Grandstand Theater.
Thanks, Bruce. Thanks, Roberto. One of the things that we saw is the connection between black baseball and Latin American baseball. And this connection goes back a long way. And if we look at the early 20th century, one of the things that we see is that Negro Leaguers were participating in Latin American ball, especially during the Winter Leagues, that Latin American baseball players would also participate in the Negro Leagues and basically excluded people who were together pursuing, of course, their love of the sport and showing themselves to be true you know, great players.
Right. They would go wherever mm-hmm. they could find, Dominican Republic, wherever they could find baseball, they could play, they would go and play because, like you said, they just love the game.
Well, money was there is one thing, and that is that at one time I know the Dominican Republican president had offered to some of the Negro Leaguers a substantial amount of money compared to what they were making to come down to Latin America and join them and play baseball.
And I think, Peter, you looked mm-hmm. at the Japanese aspect of it too, that, you know, they were playing baseball in Japan during these years. I mean, is, you know, they had as many people playing as probably we did in the United States.
Well, they had a tremendous Japanese league in California alone, all through the 20s.
Okay.
Okay. Right, and we're going to find out more about that. Bruce is joining us now with Kariyo Nakagawa, who's going to talk to us about the connection between Japanese-American baseball and eventual integration of baseball. Bruce?
Kari is a terrific expert in the subject of Japanese-American baseball, written a great book called Through a Diamond, 100 Years of Japanese-Americans in Baseball. Kari, a lot to talk about in this area, something that maybe is a little bit underdeveloped in terms of some of the research compared to the Latin American experience and also the African American experience, but nonetheless, very, very important. What's one of the highlights that you'll be talking about with regard to Japanese-Americans in baseball?
Well, my untold story, Bruce, is a story about the Fresno Athletic Club facing the Philadelphia Royal Giants in April of 1927. Here was a all-African-American team facing an all-Japanese-American team for the mystical title. Both teams were undefeated. It was played before 10,000 at Meiji Stadium. And my uncle actually went three rows into the stands to try and bring down Biz Mackey's mammoth home run. So it was really a compelling subject. The baseball diamonds were like laboratories in Japan in 1927. So here was two American teams playing for the mystical championship all the way across the Pacific, which led to this very positive bridge across the Pacific both ways, with Americans playing in Japan currently and a lot of the players from Japan today coming to America.
And we'll be talking about the connection between the Japanese Americans and World War II, another a fascinating story in your realm of expertise. Kari, thanks. We appreciate
Thank you,
your time, and we'll be hearing from you a little bit later on today. Let's send it back to the Grandstand Theater, where Doug and Matt are standing by.
Thanks, Bruce. Thanks, Kari. One of the things that we have is we're in the Grandstand Theater, and we're really fortunate that we are, because if you visit the Hall of Fame, you will see in the Grandstand Theater a short video that will help to sum up really the impact that baseball has had on history, and we really would like to show you a part of this Grandstand Theater video. Before we do that, however, I'd like to throw it over to Virginia, who will play some music for us.
Some of these songs go back almost as far as the beginning of the game itself. The first piece I'm going to be playing is called Slide, Kelly, Slide. It was written in 1908, and it was written for a Miss Maggie Klein by J.W. Kelly. The second one is called King of the Sandlots. This was a little bit later on, and this was written in 1930. It was written by Edward Mackey and Benson Barker.
baseball is a part of the very fabric of America. And at whatever level we experience it, whether we play it or watch it, from backyard to major league stadium, it's a game that speaks to us of more than box scores and starting lineups. It is a game that reflects triumph and defeat. The strength at the beginning, the wisdom near the end, the bad days and the good. Baseball approaches myth because it's a celebration of life. Because, as author Roger Angel has said, since baseball is measured only in outs, all you have to do is succeed utterly. Keep hitting, keep the rally alive, and you have defeated time. You remain forever young.
Strike! That was a strike!
Was not, it was outside!
How can you tell?
Come on, it's too dark, let's quit!
Tommy, time to come in!
Come on, one last pitch! Show me something I can hit!
What a shot!
Yes! Come on, go! Keep going! Go to second! Keep moving! Come on, just go!
That's part of the presentation that you'll see at the Grandstand Theater when you come to the Hall of Fame. I'm here today with Paul Murray, Bill Thiel, and Dave Hamula from Best Buy. They have a few words for you.
Thanks, Jim. On behalf of Best Buy family and the 80,000 employees across the country, I'd just like to express how pleased and honored we are to be hosting today's electronic field trip. Bill?
We're very proud to be in our third year of sponsorship with this program. It's a unique opportunity for technology and education to come together and offer a wonderful field trip experience to millions of kids across America. And later on in the show, both David, Paul, and myself will be getting together to award a really cool prize to the most valuable school. So pay close attention, participate, most of all have fun, and maybe your school will be walking away with a really cool prize. David?
The first trivia question for today will be to identify the two gentlemen in the picture and explain what important event took place between these two men.
Thanks a lot. Thanks to Best Buy, and back to Doug.
Thanks, Jim. Remember to call in with any answers to these questions that you might have or other questions that you might have, and also to use email. Right now we're going to go to the Pride and Passion exhibit, which is about African-American history and its connection with baseball. And joining us there are Bruce and Ted. Bruce?
Thanks once again, Doug. I'm with Ted Spencer, the chief curator of the Baseball Hall of Fame. Ted, we talk about baseball as a microcosm of the melting pot that is the United States of America. You look at the current breakdown, at least the breakdown for last year in the major leagues, 2001. About 25% of the major league players on opening day last year were foreign-born. Now, the majority of those came from the Dominican Republic. The Dominican Republic overall accounting for about 9%. Of major league players. And another very significant body of minority representation comes from the African American players. They're roughly 15% of the major leaguers today. That, of course, brings us to this exhibit, which is called Pride and Passion, the African American Baseball Experience. Tell us how this exhibit got started and why you put it together the way that you did.
Well, as Dale Petrosky said earlier, we matured over 62 years. We've really grown as an institution. During that time, we looked at the message we told, what is our mission, what should we be saying. When we came into the mid-90s, we realized that there was a big event coming in 1997, the 50th anniversary of Jackie breaking into the majors. We took that opportunity to put together a research program that culminated in this exhibit, because nothing tells the story of African Americans in American life as their experience in baseball. Mm-hmm. So basically, if you look at the early part of the exhibit, we talk about the Reconstruction period, where you'll see that blacks and whites played together.
Now, this is important to understand that Baseball black history does not just begin with Jackie Robinson. It doesn't just begin with the Negro Leagues in 1920. I mean, this goes all the way back to the 19th century.
At least. There is even some indication that Frederick Douglass played some ball when he was a slave. But basically, our story takes off when the Civil War ends and shows how blacks and whites played together up until the late 1880s when the Jim Crow laws came in. The gentleman's agreement was signed at the minor league level, which stopped the flow of any kind of ball players coming into professional ball. At that time, two brothers had already reached the major league level. The Walker brothers in 1884 played for Toledo. They only played for that one season. The black players continued to play up until, I believe, the early 1890s. They grandfathered it, but nobody was allowed to be signed into the program or after the agreements in the late 1880s.
All right, thanks, Ted. We're going to be taking some potential answers to our trivia question. Just a couple of moments ago, we asked the folks out there to identify the two players in the photograph and to tell us exactly what the relationship was between them. Right now, though, we're going to go to a youngster by the name of Corey, I believe. And Corey's from New York. He's got a question for us. Corey, go right ahead.
Who was the better league, the white league or the black league?
Well, that's a question that's often brought up. What was better, the major leagues during the early part of the 20th century or the Negro Leagues, which really existed in their most official form, if you will, from about 1920 through 1960? I guess that's a debate in terms of what might have been the better quality of play.
That'll be a question that we'll always have to try to answer. But we've talked with researchers and with ball players, and the whites, the blacks and whites, played against each other. I think that it was pretty even, although I think that you'll hear from both sides that the black players sometimes got the better of it over the white players. But they certainly were both competitive with each other.
Let's take another telephone call. We're going to go to Jackie from Texas. Jackie, go right ahead. Jackie, are you there?
Hello?
Go right ahead, Jackie.
Jackie?
Well, apparently we don't have the phone call there. Ted, we thank you for your contributions on some of the early unknown history of African Americans in baseball dating back to the 19th century, as you mentioned with Frederick Douglass, perhaps dating back even further. Let's send it over to the Grandstand Theater where Doug and Stephanie are standing by.
Hi, I'm here with Duke and Jim, and we have a student who thinks he has the answer to the trivia question.
This is Kyle from Amsterdam, New York, and he thinks he's pretty smart. Kyle, do you know the answer to the trivia question?
The two guys are Jackie Robinson and Pee Wee Reese. And the connection was that Pee Wee Reese was one of the first of Jackie Robinson's teammates to openly support him publicly.
I think we can give that to him. Good job, Kyle.
Go ahead.
Okay, we have another question. Come on down. State your name, where you're from, and ask your question.
Hello, I'm Giovanni Ruiz, and I come from Hollywood.
What's your question?
How did they get all the artifacts from the museum? Like, where did they get it from?
Okay. Ted, you want to take that one? Where did all the artifacts come from?
All of the artifacts here in the museum are donated because we are a not-for-profit organization. We rely on the generosity of the American public and the ballplayers. So we've been very happy, very successful over the years with what we've gotten.
All right. We've got another question. State your name, where you're from, and ask your question.
Sheila from Amsterdam, New York. And this question is towards Sharon Robinson. As a kid watching your father playing baseball, what kinds of physical, if not verbal, abuses did you and your family take on the field?
Okay, good question. Actually, my brothers and I integrated our schools in Stamford, Connecticut. And so my younger brother, David, who went to a private school, probably went through the most direct verbal abuse at school. My other brother and I really didn't have that kind of abuse. And we were very much comparing it to what was happening down south, where the kids were not only taking verbal abuse, but they were literally being stopped from going into their schools. Thanks for the question.
Okay, we've got another question here.
I'm Jesse Gill, and I'm from Cooperstown, New York. I was wondering, what about Jackie Robinson's personality made him the first African-American baseball player?
Thanks for that question. Thanks for that question. My dad's personality, he was very fiery, and he was always out there fighting against injustice. So I think Branch Rickey saw that in his personality. He also knew that he was really a strong character, had played on integrated teams when he was in college, and his family was very religious, and Mr. Rickey was a very spiritual man, so he was looking for all those kind of combination of characteristics.
Okay, we'll take it back to Doug.
Thanks. I understand that we have a question from Hannah in Indiana. Hannah?
Hi. I was wondering, what kind of problems did the U.S. and Japan face relation-wise when Masanori Murakami became a San Francisco Giant?
That sounds like a good question for Carrie.
Carrie will definitely handle that one.
Carrie? Oh. We'll have to get back to that question because Carrie's not available right now. We're going to get back to that question, though. We also have a question from Doug, good name, in New York. Doug, are you there?
Yeah.
What's your question?
I have an answer to the trivia question, though.
Okay, go ahead.
I think those two players are Jackie Robinson and Pee Wee Reese.
Right. And do you know about the significance of their relationship?
Well, they were two friends, and Pee Wee Reese told the people that Jackie Robinson was a good player. It doesn't matter, he's black.
That's correct. Very good. We're now going to go to a... We're now going to go to another trivia question.
Yeah.
Who wrote the letter that's shown, and why was it important to baseball? Okay, now we're going to go to the piano, and Matt's going to join us. Matt?
Thank you, Doug. The next piece I'll be playing is called Tradition, and it's one of a series of pieces known as We Are Americans Too, the words and music of which were written by Ismay Andrews.
Well, we're looking at the Grandstand Theater at the National Baseball Hall of Fame and Museum. A number of the kids and students enjoying hot dogs and soda, peanuts and Cracker Jack. Unfortunately, up here on the second floor, we're not allowed to have food or drink of any kind. But we do have a chance to talk about multiculturalism in baseball and some of the untold stories. Ted Spencer, the curator of the Hall of Fame, we saw that video just a few moments ago, had several images from World War II, which took place from 1941 to 1945. And there's really a very interesting link between World War II and the whole subject of segregation versus integration. Tell us a little bit about that dichotomy.
Well, also black Americans participated in all American wars, and just like in all wars, World War II, they were segregated from their white comrades. And the irony, one of the irony as far as baseball is concerned, is that when the military units had baseball teams on this continent, they were, had to be segregated. But when they went overseas, there was a chance they would be integrated. So that was an ironic story. However, the war itself led to really the impetus for integration. And obviously, one of the very first things that happened after the war was Jackie coming into the majors and the integration of the game. When we were doing our exhibit here, we looked at that last piece of the story and how we would tell it. And that would be the what we call the integration period from 1947, when Jackie came up with the Dodgers, to 1959, when the Red Sox brought up Pumpsy Green. We looked at that period to see what kind of a story we could tell. And what we found was very evident very quickly, and that was that the black players that came into the league were not only qualified, but they went right to the top of the spectrum. So you had 9 most valuable players, 9 rookies of the year, 5 home run champions, 4 batting champions, and Don Newcomb won the first Cy Young Award. So immediately they made this impact. To tell a side story, when I was going through that process, I came to 1958, and Orlando Cepeda was the Rookie of the Year. And I looked at this, and when I thought about this later, I put myself in the position of the owners of management of Major League Baseball earlier on, when they made skin value judgments of Latino players. And if a Latino player's skin was light enough, they were able to play, but if their skin was too dark. So I'm looking at Orlando's pictures, and I'm saying, is he black or is he Latino? Is he both? So I included him in the list. So and I was a little nervous about that, but I did it. 2 years later, Orlando becomes a member of the Hall of Fame. We bring him up into this very room. And I was wondering what he was going to do when he saw his name on the list. So we came into this room. We talked about it. He walked in. He looked around. He says, you know, my dad never was allowed to play in the major league seat, but he did play with these people. And the words weren't out of his mouth a second when he looks up and sees this photograph of the Trujillo team in the Dominican Republic, and the second man from the right is his dad. So it was quite an emotional moment. It was a great moment for me. I felt better about the decision I had made, and I think Orlando and I became great friends ever since.
Perucho Cepeda was a terrific ball player. He was often called the Babe Ruth of the Caribbean. He was a shortstop, but a hard-hitting shortstop and a tremendous athlete. Orlando Cepeda had tough footsteps to follow, but he did a pretty good job of making his own niche in baseball history. Great stories, Ted, about Cepeda, the integration period, and also the segregation and integration that took place during World War II. Let's now head back to the Grandstand Theater. We're going to send it back there to Matt and Peter. Guys, take it away.
All right. Thank you, Ted and Bruce. We're going to take a couple phone calls right now, and I think we have Josh from New York on the line. Josh, you there?
Yes. I was just wondering, did Jackie Robinson ever officially get injured in a baseball game?
That's probably a good question we'll send to Sharon.
Well, did he get injured in a baseball game? He didn't get injured to the point where he had to be out for a very long time. I'm sure he got some minor injuries, and he injured his shoulder a couple of times.
Okay, I think we have another phone call. We have Max from New York. Max, what's your question?
I would like to know, what college did Jackie Robinson go to?
Okay, I think Sharon's ready to answer that one, too.
My dad went to Pasadena City College for 2 years, and he went to UCLA for 2 years. And actually, at UCLA, that's where he lettered in all 4 sports.
Okay, we have some pictures that we're showing. Okay, we have a call from Oklahoma.
Nadia?
Nadia, what's your question?
Hi, I was wanting to know, what was Jackie Robinson's batting average?
Okay, Sharon, looks like a lot of questions for you.
Well, thanks for that question. I usually don't know too many of my dad's stats. I know more about his character, but actually his overall average was .311. So it's pretty good.
Well, thanks for that question from Navia. We also have some questions in the studio audience. We're going to throw it up now to Jim and Duke in the studio audience.
Thanks, Doug. Actually, we have the answer to the trivia question. We have Kelsey here from Cooperstown, New York, who was pretty sure that she knows the answer.
Yes, I'm Kelsey from Cooperstown, and I think that President Roosevelt wrote that letter, and the significance to baseball is that it said that The game should still be played even though the war was beginning for people to overcome their grievances.
Yeah, that's right. Good job.
Ready? Come on up. Okay, we've got another question. State your name, where you're from, and ask your question.
My name is Aaliyah Austin, and I'm from District 13, Satellite West Academy. And my question is to Buck. I wanted to know what influenced you to like start liking baseball.
We need a mic.
Maybe ask a question again. I don't know if you heard it.
She's gonna repeat it.
Go ahead.
My name is Aaliyah Austin. Please. That's better.
Louder, please.
And I'm from District 13, Satellite West Academy. And I wanted to know what influenced you to begin liking baseball.
What was it?
What influenced you to begin liking baseball?
Oh, well, and actually, for me, getting in baseball, it was actually outstanding. And what influenced me was my daddy. He was a baseball player. And the great Negro League baseball players that I knew, that influenced me.
Thanks.
I think we have room for one more question.
Okay, state your name. Come on right up.
My name is Allison Morse, and I'm from Amsterdam, New York. My question is to Buck. Just as Jackie Robinson had pressures because he was, in a sense, fighting for equality, I was wondering if you felt those same pressures, and what were they?
Did you feel pressures because you were fighting for equality the way Jackie Robinson did when you played baseball?
No, I didn't have the pressure that Jackie Robinson had. See, when they signed Jackie Robinson that contract, that was the beginning of the modern-day civil rights movement. So I didn't have that pressure when I played in the Negro League.
We see a very handsome guy on the screen right now. I think that's you.
Wonder who's that dude.
Okay, we got time for one more. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Mary Catherine Harmon from Cooperstown, and my question is, what year did they first start letting Native Americans play in the major leagues?
Good. Bach, you want to try that?
What is it? What's the question again?
What year did they start letting ball players into the major leagues?
What year did they begin letting ball players into the major leagues?
That was in 1947 with Jackie Robinson.
It was signed to Jackie Robinson.
Okay, thank you very much. And back down to Doug.
Okay, we have also some questions. We have Charlie from Texas on the phone. Charlie, are you there?
Yes, I have an answer to the trivia question.
Okay, what do you have? What's your answer?
It's a letter from President Roosevelt to Commissioner Landis, asking him to continue baseball even though it's World War II.
Good. Do you know why it is that Franklin Roosevelt was issuing that letter?
Because it was important to him.
Right.
And to the people.
Right. He was looking at trying to get things back to normal during World War II. Very good. Do we have another question?
Yes, Ian from Indiana.
Ian from Indiana, are you there? Okay, we have Molly on the phone. Is Molly there?
Hello?
Hello, Molly.
I have a question asking about the Women's League during World War II.
Oh.
How long did they play? And after World War II, when men came back from the army, were they kicked out?
I think that's a question that Ted and Bruce could definitely answer. Ted, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yes, the Women's League was formed in 1943, and it ran through 1954. I think people don't realize that it ran that long, that well over 600 ladies played in the league during its run, although it reached its high watermark in 1948 when the league drew over a million people. And I think what had happened, the reason really the league folded was that American lifestyle changed after the war, and people became more mobile. I think that was a period where you saw minor leagues maybe starting to fade a little bit. Television was coming in, and people were just doing other things. And I just don't think there was enough entertainment dollar around to support it. Although the women teams developed a tremendous following in their local areas. So even to this day, in fact, in 1988, when we opened our exhibit here, we had a number of old-time fans from the 1940s and 50s who came all the way across in November to see the opening of the exhibit.
A number of these players still come back to the Hall of Fame. Just about every Mother's Day, we have a special celebration where we have some of the alumni from the All-American Girls Professional Baseball League, and you have to love their enthusiasm. Let's go back to the Grandstand Theater.
All right, we have some great footage that we're going to show of the Negro Leagues, and I think right now we're going to roll that Pride and Passion video to show some of the images.
Baseball. Everybody played baseball. You had a city team, a county team, and everybody in every area played baseball.
I would call them hard times, but yet they were good times to us.
When I was born in Mississippi, I knew how far I could go, and that's how far I went.
We hated the conditions, certainly. We hated not getting but 60 cents a day on which to eat, 75 cents and all like that. But we loved to play.
The average restaurant that we would come across in town, it just was not the it was an unwritten law, I guess. We just don't serve you in here.
When you're doing something that you love to do, there's nothing lousy about it. And to me, I thought it was the first step toward going to the top of the world.
There's some of us who would like to have had a trial and believe that we could have made the major league, some of us.
The memory of those fellas I never will forget. We used to have a lot of fun, and then there were some sad days too, but there was always sun shining someplace. So that's what we look forward to, the big days, best days.
Okay, thank you very much. We're fortunate enough to have with us a great Negro Leaguer in Buck O'Neill. And Buck, I want to ask you about some of the friends that you had and played in the Negro Leagues. I know one of the big ones is Satchel Paige, who's a good friend of yours. How old was he when he stopped playing baseball? He was like in his 40s, right, or 50? How old was he?
When he stopped playing baseball, he had to have been in his 50s when he stopped playing baseball, but he was one of the most charismatic athletes that ever lived. That was Satchel Paige. But Debbie, you heard all the stories about Satchel Paige pulling the infield in, striking out the sides with nine pitches. Let me tell you about a Satchel Paige that I knew and loved. We played in Atlanta, Georgia. The team, the white team in the Southern League was the Atlanta Crackers. The black team in our league was the Atlanta Black Crackers. We played the Atlanta Black Crackers that Sunday, doubleheader. The next day, we're going to Charleston, South Carolina. We get to Charleston, the rooms weren't ready. Satchel said, come go with me, call me Nancy. So we go down to the docks in Charleston, had a friend there with an outboard motorboat, took us on the boat, took us to Drum Island. Drum Island is where they used to land the slaves. We stayed there about 30 minutes, and the man said, I've got someplace else I want to take you. Took us back to the docks, and he took us to a warehouse. He said, now this is where they used to auction off the slaves. Satchel and I stood there for 30 minutes not saying a word to each other. And he finally said, Nancy, I said, yes, Satchel. Said, you know what, it feels like I've been here before. I said, me too, Satchel. What he was alluding to, the fact that his grandmother or my grandfather could have been auctioned off right here where we were standing. That was a Satchel that I knew and loved.
Wow. On that very spot, too. What do you think is most misunderstood about Satchel Paige?
Had to been maybe his age, because right. Everybody thought Satchel Paige was 100 years old, but he wasn't quite 100.
Well, I know part of the legend is that Satchel was a hurler and threw really fast and hard, but he was actually a lot better pitcher than that, pitcher than that.
Oh,
right?
He was a great pitcher, had a great slider, but we didn't call it a slider. We called it a nickel curveball. He was throwing that at 90 miles an hour, and had a great fastball, too, because they clocked him at 100 miles an hour. And he said, I didn't know they were timing me, because if I had known that, I could have thrown harder. Wow. That was Satchel.
Well, there's a great pitcher for sure. And I know there's another great hitter in the Negro Leagues to talk about, and that's Josh Gibson.
Josh Gibson, great hitter. Hit the ball out of Yankee Stadium, the only guy that ever hit it out of there. Josh Gibson was a great, great hitter. And he and Satchel Paige were on the same team at one time. And Satchel said, you know what, Josh, I think you're the greatest hitter in the world, and I know I'm the greatest pitcher. Say, we're going to be on opposite side one day. They were at one time. Satchel was with the Monarchs, and he was with the Homestead Grays. Come up, we playing in the World Series, 1946. We get two outs in the ninth inning and two men on base. And Satchel said, come here, Nancy. I said, what do you want, Satchel? He said, you know what I'm fixing to do? I said, yeah, you're going to get this last guy out, and we're going to the hotel. He said, no, I'm going to walk Howard Easterlin. I'm going to walk Buck Leonard. I'm going to pitch to Josh Gibson. I say, man, don't be facetious. And he says, say what you want, and that's what I'm going to do. Frank Duncan was the manager. I said, Skipper, come in and listen to what this fool's saying. And he came out, and Satchel, I said, Satchel, tell him. He told him. Satchel, he looked up in the stands. We got 45,000 people in the stands. He said, Buck, you see all these people here? They came to see Josh, and they came to see Satchel. All right. He walked Howard Easton, he walked Buck Leonard, and I'm looking at that big bat of Josh's. I said, oh, my Lord. And anyway, he comes up. He said, well, Josh, you know when I told you that I thought you was the best hitter and I'm the greatest pitcher in the world? I said, now is the time. I'm going to throw you some fastball. Boom, 90-mile-an-hour fastball right here. Say, I'm going to throw you another fastball. Boom, 95-mile-an-hour fastball. Josh didn't move the bat. He said, now, Josh, I got you two strikes and no ball. I'm supposed to knock you down. I'm supposed to move you out of there. But I'm not going to throw any smoke in the yoke. I'm going to throw a P at your knee. Boom, strike three.
Wow, there we go. Matt, you're also going to talk to Larry for us?
Yeah, Larry had mentioned early on in the show that he has a watch, and I think that's going to lead him into some people he wants to talk about as well.
Well, Buck is wonderful in his recollections of the Negro Leaguers, and Buck, of course, was out in the West with the Kansas City Monarchs for so long, but in the East, we had, as I mentioned earlier, Max Manning in the 1940s, and Max received this watch emblematic of winning the Best Pitcher Award in the Negro National League. Max received something else back in 1937. What he received was a letter from a major league scout, probably at the same age as some of the youngsters here in the audience, looking forward perhaps to a college career. He would spend a year out in Lincoln. But the scout sent a letter to a high school phenom in 1937. The word had gotten out that Max was a great pitcher. It was a major league scout, Max Bishop, scouting for the Detroit Tigers. What Max Bishop didn't know was that Max Manning was black. There was no chance that Max could go into the big leagues at that point in time. Mm-hmm. He had to go into the Negro Leagues. He had a wonderful career in the Negro Leagues. Well, in that same 1937 year that he received this letter, Max was pitching for the Johnson All-Stars in Atlantic City, pitching for one of the really great, great players of the Negro League history, John Henry Pop Lloyd. Pop was the manager of the Johnson All-Stars at that point in time. Pop was arguably the greatest shortstop ever to play the game of baseball. Not just Negro Leagues, baseball, period. Pop is one of those great legends. He came up from Florida in 1906 and began to play professionally in that first great independent era of Negro League baseball. And you can see the photo here on the screen. Marvelous character in the man. You look at the man's face and it's full of wisdom. He was a great ball player. When he retired from baseball in 1932, he became a great mentor and role model for youth in Atlantic City. We see here on the screen a wonderful photo of Pop. We commemorate that legacy every year in Atlantic City with a program that honors that legacy, which reached out to young people and sent them off on their way in the world with a strong background. So Pop was a very, very sterling citizen and just a great, great ball player. Now, there's another ball player that I think we need to mention in the same context, the New Jersey context. Max and Pop, of course, being Jerseyites. Larry Doby. Larry's on the screen right now. Frequently gets forgotten, but you can't say Jackie Robinson and not say Larry Doby. Within 3 months of Jackie coming into the majors, Larry Doby came off of the Newark Eagles. Here he is with Lou Boudreau, his manager. Came off of the Newark Eagles to star with the Cleveland Indians. That's what the Negro Leagues did to these players. They gave them their experience and their training and their learning, and it stood them in good stead. I'd just like to kind of hit that Negro League heritage in one other way. Buck played on the Kansas City Monarchs with a wonderful player named Joe Green. I think Joe Green was a first baseman, Buck, if I'm not mistaken. And Joe put this into context at one point in time. Joe Green would say, everybody says Jackie paved the way. Jackie didn't pave the way, he would say. We paved the way. Jackie was the way. And I think that really puts the Negro Leagues into the context, the historical context that they need to be put in.
Great. Thank you, Larry. I think we have some phone calls, guys.
Yes, we do. We have Savannah from New York. What's your question?
I was just wondering, who was the first white person to ever hit a home run, and who was the first black person to ever hit a home run?
That one, maybe Ted and Bruce hopefully can take that one. That's a tough one. Hopefully Ted and Bruce.
Yeah, that's a question as far as the first white player to hit a home run. We're not sure about that question, that's for sure. We know it would go back for a long period of time.
We know it wasn't Casey at the bat.
Right. And as far as the first African-American to hit a home run, if we talked about in Major League Baseball, I'm not sure about that one.
Willard Brown with the St. Louis Ball Club.
Well, thank you very much. Yeah. There's a good. We have another question, right, from Justin. Justin, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Okay, what's your question?
Who was the greatest hitter that hit the most home runs in the 1800s?
Oh, the greatest hitter to hit the most home runs in the 1800s.
Boy, these are tough questions.
They're tough questions that we're getting.
There weren't many great home run hitters back in that time period.
That's a good point.
You know, I can point to some Negro leaguers who were great home run hitters in the early years of the league. A fellow named John Beckwith was a wonderful home run hitter. And, of course, Josh Gibson. And a fellow in New Jersey, George Mule Suttles, who Buck played against, was a great, great home run hitter.
Okay, we have another question from Mark. Mark, are you there?
Yes. When did the Hall of Fame, Hall of Fame first start?
Okay, when did the Hall of Fame open?
1939, the summer of 1939. And what's interesting in terms of the Negro League context is that that year, when they commemorated the opening of the hall, there were Negro League games played here in Cooperstown. The Mohawk Giants from up in Schenectady played the Cuban Giants that year in Cooperstown. So Negro League history here in Cooperstown goes back a long way as well.
Okay, we're going to look at a new trivia question. What year was this photo taken? Who's in this photo? What Major League Baseball team is involved? If you have an answer to that question, don't forget to call in and email us. And now we're going to go to a video across that line, but first we're going to go to Matt.
Thank you, Doug. The next piece I'll be playing is called Did You See Jackie Robinson Hit That Ball?, which was written after Jackie Robinson joined the major leagues, which will help you with your trivia question, in 1949. That was after he joined. The words and music were written by Woodrow Buddy Wilson, and it was popularized by a recording by the Count Basie Orchestra.
Second Pee-wee short. That day they met on Brooklyn's field. Their histories never seemed so real. One saw the other take the throws. He saw the spikes, he saw the blows. He heard the taunts, he heard the jeers. He felt the burden of the years. And he called for time, and then he walked from short to first. Stood and faced the man who'd faced the worst. Then these two children of the South, arm in arm, stood their ground and shut the mouths. And worlds apart, the season turns. Deep inside, that fire burns. Who knows the place? Who knows the time? When you are moved to cross that line.
Great film, and really great that it was done by a college student, Jerome Harris. Pretty exciting. We're back in the library, and I'm here with Amy, Sean, and Amin, and we're going to be talking a little bit more about Jackie Robinson. Amy, do you want to start?
Yes. How did your father react to the hate mail he received?
Well, I think my father certainly it made him very angry, but he had a chance to talk with my mother and kind of deprogram. He never brought his anger home, and I was too young, actually, to kind of know exactly how he reacted, but I know my mother said they talked about it on the way home. How about you?
I had a question about your book, Jackie's Nine, and which focuses on 9 special characteristics. And I was wondering how your father taught you and lived those 9 characteristics.
Thanks, Sean. Jackie's Nine really grew out of a program that we do with Major League Baseball called Breaking Barriers in Sports and Life. And it's based on the concept that we all have barriers or obstacles to overcome in our lives. And the values that help my father be successful, the values we teach kids to be as strategies to overcome obstacles. I'll give you an example. One of the barriers one of the values is commitment. And my father, a little known fact, my father used to test the ice for us before we were allowed to go ice skating. We had a lake in our backyard and it froze over, and he used to test the ice. And he would get out there and it was 10 feet deep at the deepest point, and we would stand on the bank cheering him on. And my father was a big guy, as you know, and he was out there by himself with us cheering him out from the bank. And it turns out my father was the only one amongst us who couldn't swim. So that was his commitment to his kids and to the neighborhood kids to make sure the ice was safe for us, even though he couldn't swim. Thanks. How about you, Amin? Do you have a question?
Yeah, my question was, how was your father's experience in the Army?
Ah, good question. My dad was a second lieutenant, and he was sent down to Fort Hood, Texas. It was during the Jim Crow era. And he was on a bus. I'll give you an example of the injustice he faced there. He was on a bus heading into town, and he got on the bus, and he sat down up front and was talking to this woman who the bus driver assumed was white. And the bus driver told him to go to the back of the bus. My father refused. They had an argument. They actually had my father arrested, and he was court-martialed over that incident. So I think his experience in the Army was, part of what made him strong and taught him about injustice. Okay, moving on. How about you?
An interesting fact I would like to ask you about. First, I think we have a phone call.
Oh, we have a phone call coming in from New York. Eric. Hi, Eric.
Hello?
Good morning, Eric. What is your question?
How old was Jackie Robinson when he first started playing Major League Baseball?
Jackie Robinson was 27, so he was a little bit older than our athletes today. Is that correct? Okay, thanks, Eric. Oh, Zach? Good morning, Zach.
Yeah, hi.
Do you have a question?
Yes, I have a question for Sharon Robinson.
Okay, hi.
Who was Jackie's favorite Major League player as a kid?
Oh, Zach. I don't know the answer to that. He loved Satchel Paige, some of the Negro League players. He admired them, and he certainly had. But I don't know who his favorite was in the majors. So I have to pass on that question. Okay, going back to Amy. Amy, do you have a question you want to ask?
Interesting fact I would like to ask you about. Your father was born in Cairo, Georgia, but he was raised up in California.
Yes.
Is that right?
That's correct, and actually it was an interesting story. His mother took her 5 children and brought them all the way across country in a train during a really hard time in this country for black people, and she had been left by her husband had left the family, so she couldn't remain in the South. And she worked 2 jobs and raised her kids to really believe in education and working hard and to stick to their religion. So she was a good, strong, single parent. Moving on. Sean, do you have another question?
I had a question about the 50th anniversary of your father breaking the color barrier. And I was wondering how your family felt about Major League Baseball retiring his number and about how some of the players now, like Mo Vaughn, are still wearing it.
Okay. Actually, Sean, that's a very good question. In 1997, baseball retired his number across the country with his big ceremony at Shea Stadium. And it was on the monitor, actually. You see the 50th anniversary, and you've got the commissioner of baseball and President Clinton and my mother in the middle. So we didn't know how the fans were going to react when the commissioner made that announcement. The fans just jumped up out of their seats, and it was very spontaneous, so we were very excited about it. We also love the fact that Mo Vaughn and others continue to wear his name in honor of my father. So it's like, what's important to us is keeping his legacy alive and making it be a living legacy. So whether it's on the numbers retired out in the stadiums or players are wearing it, as long as we're talking about the period and talking about Jackie Robinson and what that meant to baseball and to the world, it's good for us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, we got a call from Richard from New York. Richard?
My question was, what other teams did Jackie Robinson play for besides Brooklyn?
Good question, and it's an interesting one. He actually played for 10 years for the Brooklyn Dodgers and was traded towards the end of his 10th year to the New York Giants, although my father announced his retirement just at the same time they were announcing the trade. So he never played for anybody else other than the Brooklyn Dodgers. Can we go back to Amin? Amin, did you have a question you want to ask?
Yes, we have a league questionnaire here, seeing that your father played more than one sport.
Mm-hmm.
And my question was, why did he pick baseball out of all the sports he played?
Well, we've been talking about, you know, access and opportunity. And actually, my father, by the time he graduated from college, he didn't have the opportunity to play in any other sport. And Branch Rickey brought him into baseball. So it wasn't really so much he chose it. Because it wasn't his favorite sport. He's very good in many sports. But it was really who gave him the opportunity. Okay, you guys are wonderful. Thank you so much, and thank you for calling in. We're going to go right on back to Doug. Oh, actually, we're going to Bruce. I'm sorry, we're going to Bruce.
We're in the Hall of Fame gallery, and right now I'd like to introduce one of the students participating in today's activities, Amanda Lopez, who will be reading a poem for you. Amanda, it's all yours.
It hurts. Everyone looks at us different if they only really knew. Of all the pain and name-calling we have to suffer through. They think it doesn't hurt, all those names and words they say, but one day they'll finally regret. For forgiveness, they will pray.
Nicely done, Amanda. Amanda, that was done by a friend and classmate of yours, correct?
Yes.
Very nicely done. All right, some of the other people that are joining us here, in addition to Amanda Lopez from Lynch Middle School, we're joined here in the Hall of Fame gallery by a young man from Puerto Rico named Jaime Julio. Jaime is a student at Amsterdam High School, and also with us once again is the eldest of the three sons of the late Roberto Clemente, Roberto Clemente Jr. And I understand, Jaime, Roberto Clemente, a hero to you and your father as well, and you're very anxious to ask some questions of Roberto's son, his eldest son. Go right ahead, Jaime.
All right, Roberto, while you were growing up, did you think about being a baseball player like your father did?
Well, actually, yes. I had it in my blood. I loved the game of baseball. I worked very hard to play baseball, and I signed professionally in 1994. I got hurt in 1986, which took me 3 years to get back into baseball. And actually, we'll talk about Frank Robinson. Frank Robinson was the manager of the Baltimore Orioles when I came back in 1988-89. And being hurt, it was one of the things that I talked to young people and young people like you, that you should have the opportunity and make sure that you have the education for life, because you never know what's gonna happen. You can have the ability to play a game of a sport, any sport, but you can never, ever take away your education. So you can actually get hurt and fall back on your education, and that's one of the things that happened to me. And yes, I worked hard, but it never happened to get to the major leagues. I got to throw a triple-A ball, but I got hurt. So it's one of the things that, in my case, I feel very fortunate that I was able to fall back on my education and be able to work on it.
I got another question is, who inspired your father to be a baseball player?
Well, many people did, but there was one person in particular, actually. And it's funny because in Puerto Rico, the Negro Leagues played in San Juan, Puerto Rico. There's a park called Sixto Escobar in San Juan, Puerto Rico. And what happened was that he used to go and climb up on a tree and watch them practice and go play the game. And there was one particular player that dad used to look at. It was Monter Irving. And Monte Irving was a great player. I mean, he played in the Negro Leagues and then I went into the Major Leagues. But he actually, Monte Irving looked at him and one day he says, I see you every day here. Carry my bag so you can come into the stadium. So he carried Monte Irving's bag into the stadium and went in for free. And after he came into the stadium, Monte Irving actually threw him his glove. And Dad kept that glove as his and had a glove of his own. And ironically, the same day that my father was inducted as being the first Latino inducted into the Hall of Fame was the same day that Monte Irving was inducted into the Hall of Fame. So both were inducted in the Hall of Fame the same day. And those are ironies of life and baseball, if you want to call it that way. And it's something that I'm pretty sure that he was very proud of. At the same time, you know, Dad growing up and watching the Negro Leagues and growing up with that tradition inspired him to become a better person, a better player. And he really came up to a way that nowadays they will, you know, remember him as a human being, as a great humanitarian.
Terrific story and great how a Latino ball player could found a hero in a Negro Leagues ball player. Thank you to Roberto Clemente Jr., also Jaime Julia from Amsterdam High School, and of course Amanda Lopez from Lynch Middle School. We look all very different, different heights, different skin colors, but we all share, the four of us, one common trait. We're all Puerto Rican, Roberto and Jaime, born on the island of Puerto Rico, Amanda and myself, both Puerto Rican as well, but born here in the United States. Let's now send it back to the Grandstand Theater. It's time for our seventh inning stretch. We're going to send it to Virginia and Matt.
Time to okay, sing, take me out we're to the ball game. Sing, so take me out stretch. To the ball game. Is the crowd ready?
Be out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Find me some peanuts and cracker jacks.
Hey. Okay, Matt.
Okay, I think we have, we're fortunate enough right now to have John Franco of the New York Mets on the phone with us. And John Franco has a very interesting story about the unfortunate tragedy of the 9/11 incident. Mm-hmm. And John Franco has a personal story and involvement that he wants to share with us, I believe. John, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Hello. John, I just wonder if you could share with our audience just some of the personal involvement of yourself. I know you have some family members who were involved, and if you could share that with us, we'd appreciate that.
Sure. Well, 9/11, of course, we all will never forget what happened, especially me being from New York, born and raised in New York. I've had a lot of friends who worked in that building, and I also have a lot of friends and relatives who are firemen also. You know, when the planes crashed into the World Trade Center, it felt like a piece of me went with them too because of all the closeness that I have with the people who work down in that area. And unfortunate for myself, I lost a dear friend, well, two firemen who were in that building. One was my son's Little League coach that we lost, and they still haven't recovered the body yet. And another friend of mine that I grew up playing football with that I still haven't recovered the body yet. So kind of hit real close to home. But, you know, when you hear something like that, and then you, as a ball player, you try to reach out and do your best and try to help out as best you can.
Right. And one of the things you mentioned about that, John, I know maybe if you could share with us where the idea came from that I know yourself and your teammates wore the hats honoring the fire department and the police department down in New York City. Where'd that idea come from?
Well, we were just throwing it around a little bit, and our clubhouse equipment manager, Charlie Samuels, came out with the hats one day and said, would you guys like to wear this? And, you know, everybody jumped at the opportunity. So we were always supposed to wear it for one day, and As we won that ball game, we kind of gathered around Charlie and myself and Al Leiter said that we'd like to wear it for the rest of the season, and which we had to get permission from the commissioner's office in Major League Baseball. And to a man on the team, I think even if they would have said no, we would have done it anyway. Kept wearing them just to pay tribute to all the firemen, police, and EMS workers in the World Trade Center disaster. So we kind of wore it, and they kind of agreed with us, and we wore it all the way through, and then we decided to donate a day's pay of our salary. So for some of us, it wasn't a lot of money. For some of us, it was a lot of money, but the money wasn't the issue. The thing that we wanted to do was to just try to help out the families who were in need, and that's what we did.
That's a tremendous story, John. And one of the things, too, if you could say, is anything the Mets still involved in, anything currently that is taking place down in New York?
Right now we're getting ready to go down to spring training, so a lot of guys aren't around, but I know the organization has done everything they can and will continue to do to help the families of the firemen and policemen. I believe that we'll be flying some of the firemen children down to spring training to spend some time with the players and go out to dinner with some of the players. And I know Bobby Valentine, our manager, has been closely involved with a special family in Brooklyn that he kind of adopted since their father was lost in the World Trade Center. And he was a fireman. He just worked for one of the companies in the building. So Bobby has been more or less taking the kids around to various functions, hockey games and so on and so forth, World Series games. So a bunch of us are still involved, but now it's time to go back to work. But we won't forget. And if they do call and we have the time to help them out in any which way, we'll be happy to do it.
You know, thank you so much for sharing your story, and we look forward to talking again in the afternoon.
Okay. We have another untold story that has to do with Japanese Americans, and we're going to switch to the Pride and Passion exhibit with Bruce, Kerry, and Kurt, and Kurt is going to read a poem for us.
Go ahead, Kurt. Boy among men. Go ahead.
A boy among men. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These are tough, strong men, wise to the ways of strategy and survival. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These men who could handle crates and shovels, who could handle heat. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These men who could shoulder history, who could shoulder responsibility. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These men of serious spirit, of serious dignity. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These are the men who could give and take as good as any on a level field. Don't be deceived by the smiles. These men of grace and skill, of power and will, who could stride from the shadows of the barracks and guard towers just to play a little ball, smiling.
That poem was written by Lawson Fusao Inada and read by Kurt Bergfjord, a student at Cooperstown Central School. We're now joined by an expert on Japanese-American baseball, Kerryo Nakagawa. A lot to talk about with this story. Let's go back to the pre-World War II days. Really, I guess that's where it starts for us.
Well, as early as 1899, Bruce, here were teams in Hawaii coming over to the mainland. They were developing this bridge across the Pacific, going from America to Japan, and teams from universities and merchant teams from Japan coming to America. These Nisei, second-born generation Japanese Americans, were playing and competing with icons of the game like Lou Gehrig, Babe Ruth, Tony Lazzari, Jackie Robinson, a lot of the all-stars of the Negro Leagues, Biz Mackey, Rap Dixon, Frank Duncan. So in the 20s and 30s, it really was the heyday. It was the golden years. They wanted, when they put on the uniform, it was like putting on the American flag. The immigrants that came over as early as 1872 already understood the game. So I think it went as far as even more in terms of the research, where they wanted not only to prove how American they were, but to prove how well they can compete at any level.
World War II begins in 1941. Shortly thereafter, a number of Japanese American citizens are put into internment camps. Tell us about that and its relationship to baseball.
Well, it was tremendous ironies. You know, on December 6th, you're eating apple pie, you're an American. On December 7th, you know, all of a sudden you have the face of the enemy. The ironies was that it was only the West Coast Japanese Americans that were considered disloyal. If you lived in Utah or the East Coast, you were a loyal American. Another irony, once you got into the camps, were that if you put on a baseball uniform, it gave you free passage to go from Gila River, Arizona, to Heart Mountain, Wyoming, or to Granada, Colorado. Baseball in the camps was very organized, 32 teams, three divisions. to be able to put on a uniform. If you had a relative that passed away, you couldn't leave the camp. Hmm. But it did give you free passage. It was a healing agent. It was it gave them a sense of normalcy. It felt like home. It was a very positive morale booster. Hmm. For all the different 10 camps and internees.
Now, after World War II and after the Japanese citizens are released from these internment camps in the U.S., what happened next?
Well, it was a post-war resettlement. The leagues were so organized in California, Oregon, the Rocky Mountain states, Utah, Colorado, Wyoming, even in Hawaii. So they really got reorganized. It took about another 30, 40 years for a player to get to the major league level. But I always championed that we had players in the 20s and 30s that, if they were given the opportunity, could have played at that level. But Ryan Kurosaki, Len Sakata, Don Wakamatsu, Onan Masaoka, you know, and these are third and fourth generation players that really kind of stepped up and gave others opportunities. Now we're seeing this very positive bridge across the Pacific coming with players that go to Japan that were post-war players that really showed the American style. Now we're having players like Ichiro and Shinjo coming to our, you know, country and stepping up and doing well.
Kariyo Nakagawa, we thank you for your expertise. Let's go to Jim in the Grandstand Theater.
Well, we have Best Buy people back with us today.
Good job.
They're going to announce the winners of the Grand Slam package.
Great. First off, Bill, why don't you describe what our home run package is?
Okay, the home run package to the lucky school, the most valuable school today, is going to receive a computer package from Best Buy consisting of an 80-gig hard drive computer, VPR matrix computer, a 17-inch flat panel monitor, a photo printer, and a digital camera. So that's a great package. So good luck to the winning school. Paul?
Outstanding. Drum roll, please. And our winning school is Richfield Springs out of New York.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Congratulations to our neighbors, Richfield Springs, and back to Bruce and Doug.
Okay, I'm the setup man.
All right, we're back in the Hall of Fame gallery. I'm with the president of the Hall of Fame, Dale Petrosky. We have just a few seconds remaining, Dale. What has this experience, broadcasting like this, having an interactive event like this, been for the Hall of Fame? What's it been like?
Well, we have such a great educational resource here. We are a nonprofit educational institution, and we're up in upstate New York. But the opportunity to use baseball as a teaching tool in all these different subjects, and particularly in the area of multiculturalism, because it's so rich in multiculturalism, mm-hmm. and take it out to the American people as far away as Alaska, is one of the great moments in Hall of Fame history for us.
Dale, we thank you for your contribution. We thank all of our experts for their insightful analysis throughout the day. We'd like to thank Best Buy, Project View, the folks at Ball State, and of course the people here at the Hall of Fame. Thanks for tuning in. We hope you've enjoyed this broadcast from Cooperstown, New York.
Fantastic. All right, great. I watched you. You did great. That was a great morning, huh?